Dr. Marc Edwards is the Charles Lunford Professor of Civil Engineering at Virginia Tech, where he teaches courses in environmental engineering, applied aquatic chemistry, and engineering ethics. Engineering ethics. His research group aspires to pursue science as a public good through laboratory work on practically important but underfunded topics such as corrosion in buildings and opportunistic premise plumbing pathogens. That work laid the groundwork for investigative science uncovering the 2001 to 2004 District of Columbia lead crisis, and of course the 2014 through 2016 Flint water disaster. In 2013, Marc was the ninth recipient in a quarter of a century of the IEEE Barris Award for courageously defending the public interest at great personal risk. And in 2016, he was named amongst the most influential people in the world by Fortune and Time magazine. Ladies and gentlemen, Professor Marc Edwards.
Really, I just do appreciate the opportunity to come here and tell you about this journey that my team's been on now for about 14 years. And we started out as kind of a normal research group, a normal professor, and this was in 2003. And during this time, we've learned a lot about ourselves, we've learned a lot about our profession, we've learned a lot about the human race. And one of the questions that we've been asking ourselves on this journey is, as engineers, what are we prepared to do to defend the health, safety, and welfare of the public? This is the first canon of civil engineering. It's supposed to guide all our principles. And how did we get to the point where we literally had to break all the rules that we were taught as engineers and as team scientists to expose the water disaster in Flint, Michigan? And for me, this journey actually started out in Washington, D.C. from the year 2000 to 2004. This was a time period when lead in water was very high in our nation's capital, and it was high over 100 parts per billion in tens of thousands of Washington, D.C. homes. It started out innocently enough. The EPA was trying to do something good. They were switching from chlorine to chloramine disinfectant, and no one knew that chlorine for 100 years had been keeping lead on pipes and out of the water, and that the switch would cause lead to fall off into the water supply. This is now listed as one of the world's public health disasters and tragedies. And if you don't trust the U.S. Congress as a source, it's also in Wikipedia. You can look that up. But with the volunteer work that my students have been done over the last 13 years, we've now shown that this time period was associated with 2,000 children not born. That's one of the effects of lead. It induces high miscarriage rates. It's one of the first ways that we control family size. Women would take a lead-inducing abortion pill, and it looks like it worked then. It looks like it worked in D.C., except the pill was being served up in a glass of water. 20% of D.C. homes, just drinking one glass of water at this time, was exceeding the dose of a lead abortion pill from 150 years ago. This time period was also associated with about 200 fetal deaths, and literally thousands of young children aged 1 to 6 had their blood lead elevated above the CDC current level of concern, or also known sometimes as lead poisoning, of 5 micrograms per deciliter. And what makes this story just so fascinating, if you're a student of the history of scientific misconduct, disasters, is that this problem was completely owned by the federal government. The U.S. Army treats the water in Washington, D.C., and because it's not a state, the U.S. EPA is the primacy agency. So the only entity between the federal government and the consumer is a water company who buys the water from the federal government, and it comes out the tap in D.C. And so this represents something heretofore unseen, which is misconduct by government scientists and engineers. These are the very people we pay to protect us, the environmental policemen, who turned into environmental criminals and perpetrated what I'm going to argue is a crime. And another thing that makes this interesting is that there's no disputing the harm that lead does to children. It's not like other chemicals where people will debate just how dangerous it is. It's official U.S. government policy that there is no safe level of lead exposure, period. So when this became known in early 2004, people in D.C. went crazy with anger, because they realized that they had been exposed to this best-known neurotoxin for 3 years without being told that they should be taking steps to protect themselves and their families by flushing, by using bottled water, or lead filters. There's not really a problem with lead in water. The problem is if you don't know about it and you can't protect yourself. And I was working on this as a young engineer, and I was actually hired by EPA to solve this problem in late 2003, and it's a long story, but pretty soon we had disagreements. I was no longer working with the EPA on this. And I was involved in a meeting that was in early 2004, a congressional investigation. You could kind of see just the awkward position that EPA was in. So I'll play you a little clip from that hearing.
Anything like this happen anyplace else in the country to this degree? I mean, is there any precedent for this?
There is a precedent. Not to this degree, though, Congressman. I mean, there are instances.
So this is the worst case that's ever happened in the country in terms of the level and length of exposure to lead through the drinking water. Is that a fair statement?
Yeah, that's a good point. Staff's informing me that at Superfund sites, I mean, there are lead contamination problems.
Oh, hazardous material sites. Well,
right,
yeah.
Right. But in terms of
Okay, so you can tell it wasn't reassuring when the EPA had decided to go to a Superfund site to get more lead than what was coming out of the tap in D.C. So this really showed, you know, the awkward position that the agencies were in, because it's truly unprecedented. It was their lead. They caused this problem, and they covered it up for 3 years. And at one point, people were so mad, realized lead was high in the U.S. Congress. President Bush, in 2004, had two questions at his press conference whether he was drinking too much lead in the White House water. And so this is one of the biggest news stories of that year. And at one point, there were six separate congressional investigations looking into this. How could this be allowed to occur? Try to hold people accountable. And when Government Accountability Office said they were going to get involved, here was the response of the city. Take a number. It's like a Soho bakery around here. So many people are investigating us, they're going to start tripping over themselves. So this is the moment. It's March 2004. We've just exposed this horrible problem in D.C. And you have a hope. In your heart, you have a hope that we're human, we screw stuff up, that's what we do. You know, should be a Geico commercial, right? But you hope that we will learn from our mistakes so we do not repeat them. And we have six congressional investigations, GAO, everyone's investigating them, but something was about to happen to make sure that we would learn nothing productive from this mistake. Something was going to happen to derail any hope that we could learn from this tragedy. And in this case, what it was the U.S. Centers for Disease Control came into town and claimed to study the harm that was done by this 3 years of exposure. And when they wrote it up in their Morbidity and Mortality Weekly Report, I kid you not, their conclusion was essentially a miracle had happened, no one was hurt. Not a single man, woman, or child in D.C. had any evidence that their blood lead had raised above CDC's level of concern by the exposure of lead to water. And the city just breathed a huge sigh of relief. Oh, my gosh, because parents were out of their mind with concern about what happened to their kids. Well, we now know that the CDC falsified this report. On the day that it came out, the lead author was asked by a higher up at CDC, "How is your report going?" She responded, "Today has been the first day in over a month there wasn't a story on lead and water in the Washington Post, and also the first she hadn't been interviewed by at least one news outlet. I guess that means it worked." So, it worked. How'd it work? They covered up all evidence of harm and eliminated any chance that we would hold the perpetrators of this crime responsible. So then, if that's not bad enough, and we didn't know about this until congressional hearings about a decade later, a few days go by. What was the impact of this report on the lessons learned? Incredibly, the agencies that perpetrated this crime, I kid you not, they started to blame the public. 3 days after the CDC report came out, you look in the Washington Times, they ask, what's the lesson that was learned from Washington, D.C.? It's the public gets hysterical about lead in drinking water, making much ado about nothing, and as we've just learned, since no one was hurt, EPA can claim, because there was no harm, there should be no foul. And a pediatrician actually wrote into the Washington Post, and based on this falsified CDC report, actually claimed, the amazing thing we learned about this experience in Washington, D.C. is that kids can drink any amount of lead in water and it won't hurt them. They'll just pee it out. Okay, you think that's bad enough, right? You're wrong. Okay, you cannot make this shit up, people. A year goes by, and the perpetrators of this crime start to give themselves awards for what happened. I was dumbfounded. I'm doing a Freedom of Information Act request years and years later. EPA Region 3, who oversaw this problem, whose regulation it was they were trying to do and inadvertently caused the lead release, and they allowed this to go ahead with no corrosion control, they covered this up. They gave themselves the gold medal highest honor award for the agency for distinguished service of environmental significance improvement and public service. And then, if that's not bad enough, these lies from this falsified scientific report start to spread elsewhere and hurt people. That's the danger of scientific misconduct. What was the lesson learned from Washington, D.C.? In Seattle, parents found very, very high levels of lead in a kindergarten classroom. They were upset. A pediatrician writes in and cites the CDC report in Washington, D.C., and said parents should not be concerned in Seattle because the CDC did this great study in Washington, D.C., and even though these people were drinking very, very high lead in their water, no one had any evidence that their blood lead had been elevated by that exposure. So this falsified report worked all right. It got the perpetrators of this crime off, got them awards. The public was dismissed as being hysterical, prone to panic with no good reason. And this lie from the scientific report was used all around the United States and all around the world to claim that contrary to 2,000 years of human history, going back to the Roman times, we knew that drinking lead in water causes harm. All of that was erased. All that knowledge was erased by this falsified CDC report. So I worked on this for 6 years as a volunteer, 30 hours a week. And ultimately, through our Freedom of Information Act request, we were able to show what CDC had done. And there was a bipartisan congressional investigation in which they discussed this public health tragedy and how CDC's flawed data and assumptions basically endangered kids all around the United States, all around the world. And this report was termed scientifically indefensible. A congressional committee could not even find the data that CDC claimed they used for the report. But realize, lying is just so effective. By the time this was figured out, it's 2010. This is 6 years after the exposures had occurred. Good luck holding anyone accountable for that. So, and then you're watching this. I'm in the hearing again, 2010. All right, CDC screwed up. Hopefully, they can admit their mistake, put procedures in place to make sure another falsification would not occur, give you some hope that we learn something from that tragedy. Again, you'd be wrong. CDC cannot admit that they've done anything wrong. Their first strategy was, when we exposed the harm that was done to DC children, a high CDC official wrote to the Washington Post and said, you know, the effects of lead poisoning on children are very subtle, and as a parent, you'd have a difficult time detecting a few points IQ loss. So that didn't go over so well. So their next strategy was to, when interviewed in the Washington Post, they said, you know, looking backwards 6 years, our report could have been written a little bit better. And when that didn't work, the current head of CDC, still to this day, Howard Krumpkin, wrapped up an investigation, quote unquote, that he did into their misconduct. What were they guilty of? In our urgency to rapidly assess the situation, we communicated scientific results poorly. We don't know how to write. So no admission of the falsification, the knowledge that they were using forged data, that they could not find data. No apology from the U.S. Centers for Disease Control. None. And then if that's not bad enough, not only did the perpetrators of this crime get off, but I found through my Freedom of Information Act requests and interviews, there were five scientists and engineers who did their job, who did the right thing, trying to alert the public to the fact that the high lead in water was being covered up and hidden, or to expose the wrongdoing at the CDC. What happened to these civil servants and engineers who did the right thing? They got fired. Got fired. Two of them won whistleblower awards, but I mean, none of them ever worked in the field again. So, you know, if you wrap this up in terms of government accountability and the lessons learned, well, there was a lawsuit initiated in 2009 after parents figured out their kids had been hurt. It was thrown out in 2013. There were five children out of thousands who were lead poisoned from this that fought for their day in court. They was finally settled out of court just a few days ago. And so for the rest of Washington, D.C., 5,000 other kids, families, no apology, not a penny of support for their extra special education needs or health needs. Nothing. And no government official was ever fired or demoted. Of course, who did get fired? The people who tried to do the right thing. And so, you know, if this is how you run your government agencies, why would you expect them to behave appropriately in a crisis? Why would you expect that they would learn anything from their mistakes? So for years and years, I spoke out about this danger of leaving these same perpetrators on the job at the U.S. Centers for Disease Control because they falsified this report in 2004. How could they be trusted with anything, right? So here you go. This is just September of this year. Same bad actors wrote another flawed and incomplete report for public housing in East Chicago, Indiana. This housing was built on a Superfund site lead smelter, and the CDC investigated and claimed there was no danger to those children. And we now know otherwise. Hundreds of kids got elevated blood lead. They're being relocated now, and the housing's being destroyed. So this brings us to the events 2014, 2015 in Flint, Michigan. And we knew that this day was going to come because, as I said, if you do not learn from your mistakes, you're going to repeat them. And we kind of prepared for the day. Unlike DC, where I sort of expected these agencies to do the right thing, I was kind of shocked when they didn't. we prepared for the day that another city was going to face a lead and water crisis, and we prepared to respond accordingly. So what I'm going to argue is that what happened in Flint, as bad as it was actually a miracle. And here we go again. So how did this start out? Well, you start out trying to do something good. And in this case, they were trying to switch to a new water source, temporary, the Flint River, for 2 years while a pipeline was being built. And here's the famous ribbon-cutting ceremony. You know, here's the Flint. This is a historic day for us, which it proved to be, not quite for the reasons they thought, though. Because a civil servant at the Michigan Department of Environmental Quality forgot to follow federal corrosion control law. They forgot to put an inhibitor into the water, orthophosphate, that had been used in that system for several decades. Why is it necessary to have a federal law to have corrosion control? First off, it's because it's the most cost-effective investment you'll ever make. For every dollar you spend on corrosion control, you're saving $10 in damage, at least, to your pipe system. You are protecting your iron pipes, keeping iron out of the water. You're protecting your lead pipes, keeping lead out of the water. You're keeping your disinfectant residual high enough so that it controls bacteria that might harm humans. So this law is so important, we have a civil servant at every state to make sure it was followed, and they forgot to do it here. So it wasn't long before Flint residents realized that something was seriously amiss. Getting a bath or a shower became uncomfortable. People started talking. Hey, I think I'm losing my hair. Are you losing your hair? My kid has rashes. Are your kids having rashes? And so within a few months after the switch, on the social media, you had pictures like this saying, you know, if you want to take a bath in Flint, Michigan, don't use normal water because it's going to make you sick. You got to take a bath in bottled water. And so people on the outside are looking in and saying, wow, what's wrong with these people in Flint, Michigan? I mean, it's a poor city. Maybe one of the reasons is they're not taking a bath in tap water. They're buying all this bottled water to take a bath in. Well, the residents, they weren't silent about this. They weren't happy about it. They complained. And this is a resident who was at a town hall meeting. Her name is Leanne Walters, and she's an American hero. She's an American treasure. This Flint mom, she has four kids and two twin boys. And she had a living experiment in front of her because one of the twins, its growth was stunted, both mentally and physically. And as a mom, you're asking why? Why is one twin not growing the same rate as the other child? Leanne Walters figured out that the child whose growth was stunted had elevated lead in his blood. She figured out that the source was lead in their water, that this water she was complaining about at a town hall meeting, 3 times hazardous waste levels of lead, 13,000 parts per billion, so high, one gulp of that water would elevate her child's blood lead from 0 to above the 5 microgram per deciliter CDC standard. One gulp, that's all it took. Leanne also figured out that the state had lied to the US EPA in writing and claimed that they were using corrosion control when they did not. Leanne Walters, this mom, figured all this out on her own. And so if you take nothing else away from today's lecture, it is that one of the most powerful scientific forces in the universe is a mother concerned about the health of her children. And if you mess with that, she's going to hunt you down and screw you up. And that's what she did. So one of the things, she had her children protected, but she didn't give up. She was concerned about other children in the city. The state was just dismissing to her, oh, you're the only one in the city with this problem. So she sought out and found an amazing EPA employee named Miguel Del Toro. Now, Miguel is known as probably the foremost expert on the lead and copper around the country. And when he heard this story, he could not believe his ears. My gosh, there's no corrosion control in Flint, Michigan. So this is April of 2015. Miguel wrote an email saying to his superiors at EPA that we should exert our emergency powers to, because the city is under an imminent and substantial endangerment, to protect kids. Miguel's supervisor, Susan Hedman at EPA, did not want to act on this information. So Miguel is worried. And the reason he's worried is the one thing that can get you fired at the US EPA today is doing your job. It's a proven fact. I've got congressional hearings that show this. You can actually watch porn on your computer all day at the EPA and not get fired for that. But I've got example after example after example of good scientists and engineers doing their job and getting fired. But Miguel, he's at the end of his career. He's a great guy. He thinks, how can I force EPA to do their job and exert oversight and protect people in Flint, Michigan? So the strategy that he set upon was to write a memo. And this came out in June 2015. And it laid out in no uncertain terms the danger that the entire city of Flint was facing from the lack of corrosion control, because EPA knew they were not following federal law. So you have one child already lead poisoned, right? You got EPA's knowledge federal law is not being followed. And incredibly, this got leaked in the press. And once again, his supervisor, Susan Hedman, told Miguel that this was not EPA's job. What's more, she told Miguel through the EPA ethics officer that he was not to ever again speak to anyone from Flint or about Flint, Michigan. So Miguel was off the case. And later, EPA stood by as the state of Michigan publicly discredited him, calling him a rogue employee who did not speak for the US EPA. They said nothing to defend what Miguel had done. So the next day, he was upset. He was off this case. He wrote to his colleagues, you know, I'm really tired of bad actors being defended, bad actions being ignored, and the folks trying to do the right thing are the ones who are scrutinized as they were doing something wrong. I truly, truly hate working here. EPA is a cesspool. So at that point, a new EPA employee came on the scene. Miguel was out. Here's an example of sort of EPA's attitude. People are complaining about the water in Flint. They're calling up EPA. Here's Jennifer Crooks emailing her colleagues at the Michigan Department of Environmental Quality, who they knew had lied to them about the issue of corrosion control. Yep, another complaint about our favorite water supply, smiley face. Let me tell you, this is a nasty situation. People are calling me up, calling me four-letter words, telling me I'm a crook, but I'm developing a thick skin. And 8 months after EPA knew that federal corrosion control law was not being followed, here's an email that the congressional investigation uncovered where EPA said, basically, Flint is not a community we want to go out on a limb for. So here's the situation. People are marching in the street. Children, adults have rashes. Crap water is pouring out of the tap. And Flint residents at this point are still being told that their water is safe to drink. The mayor of Flint, he actually was concerned about this EPA memo. He asked about it. He reached out to Susan Hedman, again, the top cop in the region, the head of EPA Region 5, Miguel's supervisor, asked if there's anything he should be worried about. She apologized for the memo, said that she'd get back to him if there was anything to be concerned about. So he goes on TV and tells everyone in Flint that he drinks the water every day and they should drink it as well. And to this day, Flint residents blame this mayor for going on TV, but he had just asked Susan Hedman at the EPA if there was a problem, and she basically said, no, I don't see why a politician's being blamed for the failings of the environmental policeman. And so, at this point, you know, you got to say, you got to give them credit where credit's due. They're so bad, they're good. And what I mean by that is, here's the situation. You have the second poorest city in the United States, Flint, Michigan. They are paying not only the highest water rates in the United States, but amongst the highest water rates in the world. For water that we now know, due to high bacteria levels and high lead, is not suitable for anything but flushing toilets. And they're told to like it and to drink up. And if that isn't bad enough, when Leanne, the residents, went to the Michigan Department of Environmental Quality to complain about the lack of corrosion control and in the memo and why was no one doing anything to protect Flint's kids, these engineers and scientists, these civil servants, laughed in the face of Leanne Walters. And they actually bragged to her and said, Mr. Del Toro has been handled and no one will be helping you. So at that point, when she called this up, I don't remember much about the next few hours. My wife says I was mad, and I believe her. And I wasn't really ready yet, you know, to fight this battle. I mean, I just sort of recovered from the DC thing, and I'm like, I'm hoping that this is going to happen in a few years so I could save up more money. But, you know, you don't get to choose the time and place at which an environmental injustice appears on your doorstep. So, you know, this was it. So we launched our relief effort, and literally we just basically broke all the rules. This was completely self-funded for money that I'd saved up because I knew the day was coming. I knew we'd repeat the DC tragedy, unfortunately. We owed no one anything at all in this venture. And essentially, we just declared war on our government science agencies who were perpetrating what we felt at the time was a crime on one of our most vulnerable populations in the United States, in Flint, Michigan. So the first step in this war, we did the job that the agencies were paid to do, but refused to do. We sent sampling kits to Flint, and the residents did an amazing job. They returned 90% of those kits, and we showed that lead was high throughout the entire city. We also had to engage our beleaguered fourth estate, the media. You know, there's hardly any such thing as an investigative reporter nowadays. So we had to make simple experiments that even they could understand and use to present this to the public. And this is an example of the type of experiment we did where we took little pieces of steel pipe and we exposed it to the Flint water without corrosion control on the top and also to Detroit water with corrosion control on the bottom. So, you know, the message is very clear. You used to have Detroit water. It wasn't eating your pipes up. But now you've got Flint water on the top. You see all that orange stuff? That's rust. That's you destroying your pipe network. That's why we have corrosion control. And by the way, Flint residents holding these bottles up, they're not crazy. So when this first came out, the press ran with it. And the state insisted that there was no difference in the corrosivity of Flint water versus Detroit water. Publicly. It was around that time that GM, which is in Flint, they stopped using Flint water because it was eating the parts up on their assembly line. And they switched to Detroit water. And the Michigan Department of Environmental Quality, we have emails now where they were bragging that they convinced reporters the fact Flint, that GM couldn't use it to produce parts on their assembly line had nothing to do with its healthiness or corrosivity in Flint. We started other experiments as well that got at the health issues. This is samples of lead solder that were connected to copper. And again, it's a very simple thing that anyone can understand, right? You take the Flint water, you take the Detroit water, you put these samples with a common source of lead in there. You see the white stuff in the water on the left? That's lead. That's three times hazardous waste levels of lead, the same levels that we had in Leanne Walter's house. Flint water without corrosion control was wreaking havoc on the system. It was creating a public health hazard. No such problem in Detroit water. So this is the type of experiment that the state was required by law to do before they made the switch. They didn't do it. So we said to them, you know, one of the great things about science and engineering is you can repeat experiments. We actually sent them these samples so that they could take Detroit and Flint water, which they have running out of the tap in their offices. It takes 4 days to repeat this experiment. They kept insisting there's no difference in corrosivity between the two sources. So here you go. They refused to do the experiment. Wouldn't do the experiment. So at that point, we got really nasty. I took the experiment to a fourth grade classroom. They were able to do it. They saw the same thing we did, and they got on television, and the state looked ridiculous. And we then actually engaged little brownie troop scientists, and we had them do an experiment on the Flint water, and we had them write letters to the governor outlining their concern about what happened to the kids in Flint. And I actually took these letters, and I sent it to EPA headquarters in Washington, D.C., and I said, isn't it amazing that these little kids understand what's going on here, and you, the environmental policeman at the EPA, who've been allowing people to cheat on the lead and copper rule since the Washington, D.C. lead crisis, which you perpetrated and got away with, that you don't get it. The EPA doesn't get it. So this was embarrassing for them. And unfortunately, that's the only thing these people understand, by the way, is something that looks embarrassing to them. You'd hope you could reason with them, like scientists and engineers. These are not reasonable people. So I'm kind of proud. Around this time, the state of Michigan was trying to figure out what to do with us, because in a million years, they never expected that someone would come in the way we did and start working with residents and doing all these experiments. So this email is one of my favorites. It's September 10th, where they're saying, if we're going to take action, it better be soon, before Virginia Tech scandalizes us all, because it took them 6 years to expose this problem in D.C., and we're only a few days into this here, and it's not looking good for us. So it was a few days after this. It was too late. We'd already decided we were going to break the rules and take a stand with Flint residents. This is not something you normally do as a professor, by the way. It's a good way to get yourself fired. Believe me, you can be fired as a professor. But we actually went up and had a protest on Flint, and we showed the simple experiments to reporters. I called it an epically bad decision, and that this is a real problem here. And we started working with a local medical doctor. His name is Dr. Mona. And she repeated the blood lead experiments that I'd done in D.C. using data from the local hospital. And at that point, she showed that in some Flint neighborhoods, the incidence of childhood lead poisoning had tripled on the time that they were on the Flint water. So at that point, things started to happen very quickly. This is 6 weeks after we launched our relief effort. It was front page of the New York Times. And not long after that, the impossible happened. They said they could never go back to Detroit water. And believe me, when they found out that neighborhoods of children were getting lead poison, they figured out a way to turn the valves and make the water come out. So that was in October. And it wasn't long after that before the entire country, and indeed the entire world, realized that what happened in Flint, Michigan was a crime. It was an environmental crime perpetrated by our government, the environmental policemen we pay to protect us, against one of our most vulnerable populations, the children and people living in Flint, Michigan. And if you as a society are judged by how you treat your most vulnerable, we don't look very good, folks. We do not look very good as a result of this tragedy in Flint. So at that point, President Obama declared a federal emergency, and it became a cause du jour for celebrities and for almost everyone to give bottled water to Flint, Michigan, which was desperately needed. In fact, one of the dangers right now, one of the greatest public health dangers in Flint, is there's so much bottled water being hoarded because the residents are afraid that they're not going to keep getting bottled water, that some of the houses are on the verge of collapse, literally. We're in basements where floors are buckling under the weight of case after case of water being stored. So the population is just terrified of the water coming out of their tap, even though it's now Detroit water and it's relatively safe. So FEMA resources were mobilized to do blood lead testing of the children. And another consequence of the fact of the lack of corrosion controls, we destroyed their vital infrastructure, their water system. So this is what a commute looks like in Flint, Michigan today. They currently have about 100 times the water main breaks of a normal U.S. city. And so much damage was done to these pipes, financially it's impossible for Flint residents to ever repair those pipes by themselves. They need our help. So here we go again. You know, we screwed stuff up. You think you're going to learn something from the mistake? So went to Congress twice earlier this year, once with Leanne, once with Ms. Hedman. And incredibly, after this tragedy, I sit there, and there is EPA testifying under oath, quote, "We had nothing to do with what happened in Flint, Michigan." EPA testified that they didn't know if they could enforce federal law or not, and the state strong-armed them. And then, if that's not bad enough, we also predicted that another effect of the lack of corrosion control would be Legionella. Legionella is a bacteria, grows in drinking water. Corrosion eats up the disinfectant that's in the water supply. Our initial data showed that Legionella was very high in Flint buildings during the water crisis. When we went and told the state about our data, they acknowledged that they'd known about an outbreak since 2014 and that they did not want to tell anyone about this because it would, quote, inflame the situation. And even the U.S. Centers for Disease Control, they heard about this outbreak. They wrote an email in 2015 talking about their concerns, acknowledging this is one of the worst outbreaks that has ever occurred in our country, and they wanted to come and investigate. And the state of Michigan told them, the outbreak is over. There's no reason for you to come in. And so even more people died. 12 excess deaths from Legionnaires' disease likely tied to the fact they were on Flint River and no corrosion control. So here you go. So you got neighborhoods of children with elevated blood lead, people dead from Legionnaires' disease. You destroyed a city's vital infrastructure, right? And if you're like me, you're probably asking yourself, what does it take for someone to get fired in this country from not doing a government job? Seriously, what does it take to get someone fired? At this point, no one had been fired. So at that point, it got on to Comedy Central. All right, so you got to laugh or else you'd cry, right? So now you're talking serious business. We look like an international laughingstock because we are. So Susan Hedman resigns. There have been 8 civil servants at the Michigan Department of Environmental Quality who've been indicted so far. Investigations were done looking at how this problem was occurring nationally. And just like we've been screaming at the EPA for over a decade, the Guardian did an analysis that showed that water companies were testing their water in ways that made lead look low in the numbers they report to EPA when it's high, when kids are drinking the water. Cheating, essentially, on how they do their sampling. And despite the cheating, there's 5,000 water companies in the U.S. who are still over lead action levels. And it it revealed this culture, essentially a culture of corruption where the people that we pay to protect us from this best-known neurotoxin in water were doing everything they could to hide this problem, even to the point where when Pittsburgh finally acknowledged in September of this year that they had a problem with lead in water, the former director of the utility was quoted in the paper saying, you know, I would have been fired if I would have publicly acknowledged the water was unsafe and that we were over the federal action level. So as a result of that, we've got lost trust in municipal water. Bottled water sales have outsold soda for the first time because of the Flint disaster, undermining confidence in public water supplies. And once again, we went back to the U.S. Congress, and people are going, well, what's going on with the water in D.C.? And this is just this year, June. Of course, lead's still high in the U.S. Congress. So if you ever want an explanation like why half our government seems insane at any one time, there's your answer. It's lead in the water. It's been there for forever, probably. Last place we'd want to lose a few IQ points, I guess. But, you know, a lot of good has come out of this. Because as bad as it was, we got kids protected. If we had not intervened in August, those kids would have been drinking that water for another year and a half, so help me. No one would have been told about it. We would have had more deaths from Legionnaires' disease. And when this environmental injustice was exposed, people from all walks of life, of all political parties, stood up to help Flint. There's been $9 billion in extra water infrastructure that was just approved. And of that, there's about $100 million in new infrastructure for Flint. To date, $600 million in relief has gone to Flint. That's over $60,000 per child in the city. Compare that to Washington, D.C., where the exposure was much, much worse. And those kids, they got zero. They got zero to help them with their health problems. So this has been a tough road, I won't deny. It's cost a lot of money. The D.C. battle cost myself, my family personally, over $1.2 million over 13 years. The Flint work cost $300,000, and just so you know, I don't have this much money, so figure out how that happened. I did get a MacArthur grant where they gave me a check for $400,000, and they just go away. It doesn't get any better than that. And after the president declared a federal emergency in January, we started a GoFundMe page, and people just started giving us money. So we got $300,000. Back to date, and you know, it was just incredible going to the mailbox every day, and like, you get all these checks in your mail, and it's like $10, $20, $50. One person gave $80,000 out of their own pocket. But of all those, the one I'll most remember is the day I went to the mailbox, and I got an envelope from Flint, Michigan, from a resident with a $1 bill in it. And that was priceless. So we got to dig out of a financial hole. People aren't happy with me right now in my field because we broke the rules and you just do not do that. And it's kind of crazy, sort of the retaliation you get. Of course, you're going to lose funding because EPA doesn't like you. You showed they were criminals. But, you know, I probably lost about 80% of the friends that I had when I started on this journey. Thankfully, I did not lose my job. Virginia Tech did not fire me, unlike those other brave whistleblowers in D.C. who lost it all doing the right thing. That really makes me mad. What's also fascinating is the lack of support from academia itself. And, you know, this was kind of shocking to me. Because as professors, we have tenure, we have academic freedom, and we're the last ones to exercise it. And why is that the case? This came out just 1 month ago, this editorial in the premier journal of our field, Environmental Science and Technology, where the editor claimed that what we did was a product of a culture where Hollywood sensibilities conspire to create a narrative about noble people fighting injustice. And this person argued if we professors become allies of a particular cause, no matter how just, we run the risk of exposing our community to potential retaliation, and we might lose our precious research funding from these government agencies. So this is what we're all about. Why don't we speak out as professors? We don't want to lose our funding. Okay, I know that. I lost my funding. I destroyed my funding networks, okay? So I asked him, I said, are you actually, like, calling me out for what I did in Flint, Michigan? Did I do the right thing, yes or no? He actually responded, from everything I've been able to learn, it looks like a crime. And as a citizen, I'm glad someone stepped in. I'm just not convinced it should be a professor. So we're trained cowards in academia. We're absolutely trained cowards. Because we've got to keep our funding going, and that's what we're loyal to, is the people who give it to us. And we are loyal to the human race and to the first canon of civil engineering, which says it's our job to protect the public welfare. So I wrote up some of these experiences in a peer-reviewed paper, and this just came out in late September, and I talked about this perverse incentive culture and how we're so competitive with each other and dependent on funding. And I was a little bit relieved. I was kind of like bracing myself, okay, here I am calling out professors for being cowards. I'm going to get a lot of people complaining to me. I got like 500 emails thanking me for what I did. And this paper was actually downloaded 200,000 times in just 8 days, which is about 1,000 times more than any other peer-reviewed paper that came out. So this is available online if you want to see me trashing my profession. And it's taken a lot of time. So, you know, overall, it's just been like a volunteer, you know, working two jobs over these last 15 years to expose this misconduct. But, you know, I can tell you, as bad as it was, and it was really bad. Someday I'll tell the whole story. I got up every day with such a sense of purpose. And I just wish everyone could experience that once in their life. And although I did lose a lot of friends, I made some new ones. So this is a picture of four of us. That's Leanne, Miguel, Dr. Milne, and myself. And we are just four actors. There are probably 20 key groups of people who stood up to fight to expose the injustice in Flint, Michigan. And our team, we did our part. But without all of those people, those kids still would have been left in harm's way. And another kind of interesting fact is in this picture we have a renounced Catholic, a communist, a socialist, and a Republican. And it never mattered, folks. Never was an issue because, you know, there is such a thing, and we often forget it, as common morality. And that's what we were fighting for. And I think I will go to my grave knowing in my heart that Flint was exactly the type of community that I'm glad I went out on a limb for. So with that, I'll open up for any questions if you have it. Thank you so much. Really appreciate it. Well, first off, when it comes to lead and water, I think a message has been sent, hopefully, that the cheating's not going to be allowed. Let me just say, in general, I was once a proud member of the American Water Works Association. It was having to quit that group, which I did just before Flint, because of their policies on lead and water was one of the hardest things I'd ever done. I think, in general, American Water Works Association does a good job, and I was once very proud to be a member, but when it comes to lead and water, they behaved in ways that literally made the tobacco industry, could have made the tobacco industry proud. I mean, it was just mind-boggling how they worked to cheat and cover these problems up. And I was interested to to know that Miguel del Toro also quit the AWWA about the same time for the exact same reasons before Flint. So irony brought us together. But, you know, the cheating's definitely occurring. EPA's thinking about revising the lead and copper rule. I have no faith that they're going to do it. Our current faith is, our hope is with the governor of the state of Michigan, who's been so burned, badly burned by this. He wants to create the toughest lead and water, lead and copper rule in the country in Michigan, and then roll it out through the governor's association and kind of embarrass EPA to do the right thing and, you know, just do an end run around them because they're useless. They're totally useless when it comes to this particular law, even though they do other things well. So, you know, if you've been following the news, people have been finding lead in schools, which we've been arguing has been a problem for decades, and they're finding it in almost all schools they look at. So the lead issue's out there. We have to do a better job dealing with it. And I think one of the tragedies of it is we don't need a new law. I mean, the thing that makes me just so angry is if the law, the existing law had been followed and not broken, the D.C. and Flint tragedy would not occur. Federal law was broken and ignored, and people were lied to. So, but the other issue is, like, what else? If we can't be trusted with something as simple as a lead and water law, what else? You know, that's the question people are asking around the country. If you ever wanted to design a campaign to undermine completely faith in your product, potable municipal water, this would be it. This would be the campaign to destroy your brand, to destroy trust in your product in a way that you'll never be able to get that trust back for years and years and years. So there are concerns about, you know, whether there's cheating with other contaminants, and, you know, the reality is the trust is just gone. And it's very hard to get back. In terms of where the next city will be, I think the answer is that's the other concern. If it happens in Washington, D.C., which is the most powerful city in the United States, and Flint, Michigan, which is one of the poorest, it could happen anywhere. And the problem is the miracle's not going to happen. The problem is you're not going to know about it. Not the answer you wanted, but that's why people are so upset. What do you have in science and engineering? I mean, our product is truth. Our brand is trust. Once that is gone, you've got nothing. You know, so this is a major problem that we're going to have to deal with. Lack of trustworthiness in regulatory agencies, scientists, and engineers. We've got to get this fixed. Any other questions?
Mark, what do you believe is the solution here? Across all the cities, we've got a new president. He's talked about rebuilding the infrastructure for things just like this. But for water, I mean, this is a big deal.
Right.
I'm sure you've given some consideration to what kind of steps, both politically and other, need to be taken in order to
better manage this. I guess the answer is the solution depends on the problem. Like, we've uncovered so many problems here. You know, the question is where do you get started? So the first and foremost one that bothers me is a lack of trustworthiness in government science agencies where they are firing good, honest people and promoting weak, unethical cowards, right? And so we have to have an ability to fire these bad actors and change the culture. And right now, these agencies, they are loyal, first and foremost, to themselves, to their agency. That's what employees are rewarded for. And the idea of rewarding people for being public servants and doing their job is way down on the list. And so this is a problem across all agencies. It's the EPA, it's the CDC, it's the Veterans Administration. It's part of the reason people are frustrated. Congress actually passed a law to help clean up the VA scandal, for example, because it was too hard to fire the bad actors. They passed a law to make it easier to fire a bad actor. The first time they used it, it was overturned, and that person was put back on the job. They have, like, no ability to fire unethical, bad people from these agencies. They find a way to fire good people. So that's one. What are we going to do about cowardice in academia? That's a problem because we are so hung up on our funding, as you saw in that editorial, where, I mean, that's an issue. It's like scientists and engineers in academia I don't think we're trustworthy as scientists, you know, engineers either, because we are, I uncovered falsified reports that scientists wrote for the EPA with no data, because EPA wanted a certain conclusion and they got it. So we got problems with ethics and cowardice in academia. In the grand scheme of things, lead in water is trivial. That's what makes it such a great example. We got a law, it was broken. This is 2,000 years of human knowledge. Lead in water is bad, right? We can protect ourselves. You can use bottled water. You can use filters, $30. Put it on the end of your faucet in your kitchen. Treat the water you use for cooking or drinking. This is trivial stuff. But if you can't handle a problem like lead in water, what on earth can you be trusted with? If you can't be trusted to follow the existing federal law, why should we trust you when it comes to a shade of gray, you know? So, but the lead issue is ultimately replace the lead pipes, going to be very expensive. There's no magic pot of money that's going to appear. If you spend money on that, you got less money for infrastructure, roads, education. That's the reality. But we can solve this with either lead filters or bottled water or flushing, or, you know, there's ways to handle it. It's not... These are not expensive solutions compared to pipe replacement. Replacing lead pipes, you know, maybe average of $5,000 a house. Any other questions? So let's go with you. And yeah.
I'm just wondering, you made the $100 a day, and you made it sound like they didn't add this orthophosphate. At any point, could this have been added to start to make the water better, or
yes.
Was it too late?
They no, absolutely. Could have. That, you know, that's what so, you know, makes me so angry. Like, at one level, you'd like to empathize with them. You'd like to say, okay, they've suffered budget cutbacks. They don't have enough people. Why are you going to throw these folks in jail or try to indict them? The answer is, because they were arrogant, uncaring, and it eventually got to the point where their attitude was force us to do our jobs. If you read their emails and you see how hard they worked to not do their job, it almost makes you want to pull your hair out. They worked overtime to not do their job. It would have been one phone call, install corrosion control, feed the inhibitor, it's done. Instead, they fought to cover this up and not do their job and keep kids drinking that water. It's mind-boggling. And it's what you get at the end of a corrupt system, where it starts out where first you're firing good people and retaining bad people. The next thing, you create a culture in these agencies where folks are willfully blind and cynical. They're willing to look the other way because why should I do my job if I'm going to get fired? And you end up with what we actually saw in Flint, Michigan, where you have not just total incompetence, but this arrogant, uncaring attitude where it can lead you to laugh in the face of a mother of a lead poisoned child and brag about the fact you handled an EPA employee, and to basically sit there and say, how are you going to force me to do my job? That's where that game ended up. So it would have been the easiest thing in the world for them to feed the orthophosphate.
So was it just semantics to switch back to Detroit Water? I mean, they're coming down the same lead pipes in their house anyway. Was there any benefit to going back to Detroit Water?
Well, first off, it was less corrosive. It had the orthophosphate in it, and the city couldn't screw it up because they're just buying it from Detroit and put it in the water system. That's what they'd done. The second hope was that you could restore the faith and trust in the water supply. Now, it's taken about a year for these pipes to sort of heal again, right? But the reality is that the trust has been so completely lost that for many Flint residents, a certain percentage, they will never trust tap water ever again. Leanne Walter, she left Flint. She's living in Norfolk now. She told me, I will never again trust water from a tap anywhere in the United States, because that's how bad they were betrayed. The betrayal is so deep that many Flint residents will never take a bath or shower again. Because people died from Legionnaire's disease, breathing droplets in the shower. So they're like taking baths with bottled water, you know, sponge baths, using wipes. Essentially, you know, for many of these residents, civilization as we know it ended. I mean, think, if your water is not suitable for anything but flushing toilets, and you realize that these agencies have lied to you, misled you, left you in harm's way for 18 months, who can blame them?
A proposal, if I may, for your thoughts. There are a lot of great water testing labs represented in our association. It seems like enough good, healthy public distrust of government. So what if they would create a website, other ways of information, where it's very inexpensive to do a lead test.
Right.
So let citizens order their own bottle that they send back in and do the $20 lead test to help keep their local water source honest.
So we have that.
I mean, that's not a cure-all, but it seems government won't protect us. Maybe we need to protect ourselves.
Right, it's sad. We've set up that website with a group called Healthy Babies, Bright Futures. You can go there and get kits by mail that we'll analyze. So they serve as an interface with us. If you're low income, you can actually request that you can get a free test and maybe other people will pay for it. But, you know, in the grand scheme of things, I mean, obviously that's just putting a Band-Aid on the problem. I mean, it's not just lead and water we're worried about. We're worried about other, well, like, what are we going to do with Legionella across the country? Is the water industry capable of honestly addressing that new threat? That's a new health threat we really didn't know about 10 years ago. There's a whole host of pathogens that are growing in our hot water systems that make us sick or that kill us that we didn't know about 10 years ago. Will our existing government agencies and industry protect us from that threat? Honestly, not so sure. So yeah, there's a lot of, as I said, there's a lot of problems here, and we need a lot of solutions to deal with it, but it starts with, once again, making scientists and engineers trustworthy, not just in these agencies. I gotta say, I called out academia too, because we are so beholden to the almighty funding dollar that we're willing to betray our ideals to anyone who's funding us. And you can't assume that if a government agency is funding you nowadays that they want an ethical result, unfortunately. Yeah.
From another perspective, some of the sources that bottled water companies use and other food industries use is a municipal source. And if you're using a potable municipal source, FDA looks upon that as you're good. So I know in bottled water, a lot of us will, you know, test, do a full analysis of that municipal source, but there are many food industries that won't do that full analysis because it is an approved source, which is different from using a spring source where you are required to do the analysis.
Right.
So it's with the lack of trust in municipal systems, that potable source now becomes suspect.
Yeah, and it really is unfortunate because on average, I think the potable water industry does a good job of being honest and regulating the contaminants, as does the EPA. And so now you're painting with a broad brush because of what happened in Flint, Michigan. It's undermining trust of the honest ethical utilities, and it's creating distrust of every single thing that you look for in water. I think from the perspective of the bottled water industry, you've got a huge advantage because you can treat that water. You can use that as a raw water source, use activated carbon, to do a generic kind of removal, and but it's unfortunate that the entire trust in our water systems and water supply has been decimated, even though in a lot of cases it's not really justified. But that's the problem once you reach a tipping point of distrust. A tipping point concept is once people think that like roughly 10% of the water companies are cheating on something, that if you don't know who the bad actors are, you're going to assume everyone is cheating. Everyone is painted with the same bad brush. it's no longer possible to say it's just a few bad apples when you've had these exposés by The Guardian and NRDC and CNN showing this is a national problem. Yes.
I have one comment and one question. As you know, this is the Alan Leff Memorial Lecture Series, and he would be proud. The question is this. There's a cost to what you've experienced beside the numbers you showed up there. In terms of a cost to the public water supply, now you can hear numbers like for the next 20 years we'll spend $20 billion a year to rebuild our infrastructure and water distribution, just as a matter of treatment systems and so forth. But have you ever tried to identify the actual cost to the citizens of Flint, to the state of Michigan, and to the town of Flint, as this little event, and I'm not belittling it,
no,
but it's
right.
A microcosm of what's potentially sitting out there.
Right.
Have you tried to put a number together on that?
No, I really haven't. I can say, you know, just at one level, what happened in D.C. was 30 times worse than Flint in terms of the lead poisoning that occurred. 30 times more children, higher exposures. So that, if you prorated it, the D.C. family should have got something on the order of $6 billion for that little event in D.C. So the issue is, though, that you can't honestly appraise the cost unless you honestly acknowledge the problem. And so this is a kind of a perverse incentive of lying. Okay, if you lie about it, you claim there's no problem, of course you're never going to get it fixed. So, I mean, just look at what happened in Flint, you know. Got $9 billion in an area of pretty tight discretionary spending because, like nothing else, you got 25 years of industry claiming, oh, we need more money, ASCE arguing our pipes are failing, D-minus grade, year after year after year. What did it take to finally get some money and acknowledgement of a problem with our water infrastructure? It was this tragedy in Flint. It was an open, honest acknowledgement of the mistakes. When this kind of injustice is exposed, people step up, they find a way. So $9 billion for infrastructure nationally. So I think that's kind of the first rule of this, is let's be honest about our problems, and maybe we can get them solved. But if you're dishonest about it and pretend it's not there, why should we take money from other worthy causes to fix it? But it's a big issue, and Legionella is an even bigger deal. So we're talking about a whole new class of deaths arising from potable water exposure. And again, are we going to be honest about those deaths and that danger so that we can work with homeowners to minimize these harmful exposures that are occurring in showers? Or are we going to pretend it doesn't occur and cover it up so that we can, you know, not address the problem? I don't know. That's a new issue, and I'm a little bit concerned the direction the water industry's been taking on that, but anyway.
Thanks for staying so long with us. I really appreciate it. Good to see you again. This is going to be posted on the Dwarf website. The YouTube will be posted for everybody to look at. Thanks, everybody, for coming. Thanks.